I will try at least. Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank you to the organizers of this symposium for inviting me to give this paper, and I would like to thank all of you for being here. So the title of the topic of my paper is Educational Inequalities and Educational Justice, and there are basically two central assumptions which underlie my argument in that paper. The first assumption is that there is a kind of dialectics or dialectic tension between justice and equality. So we can distinguish between just and unjust inequalities in the domain of education. And the basic question with regard to educational justice or to justice in general is actually equality of what? So my assumption is, or my first claim is, that of course education is about certain types of equalities. That is to say that justice and educational justice should be spelled out in egalitarian framework. The question is, which egalitarian framework, which one? And the second basic assumption which underlies my considerations here is that we should make a distinction between educational justice and, say, social justice or economic justice. So we should be able to make distinctions between different domains to which the concept of justice applies. Why is that so important? Let me give an example which is very important also for my argumentation here. It becomes very common actually, at least in Europe, to spell out justice in education in terms of meritocracy. And I'm going to try to show why this is problematic, why the principle of meritocracy does not apply to the domain of education, if properly understood. So while the principle of meritocracy could be fine in the domain of labor or in the domain of economy, this principle is inadequate in the sphere of formal education. This is also an important claim or important purpose also of my argument in this paper. So what I'm going to do now is first to distinguish between three different principles of justice, three leading principles of egalitarian justice at least. So what can distinguish between the principle of distribution? This is the so-called luck egalitarianism, linked basically to the names of John Rawls and especially of Ronald Dworkin, applied in the sphere of education basically by the British-American philosopher of education, Harry Brickhouse. The second one is the principle of participation. I will call it minimalist egalitarianism. This is the so-called capability approach developed by Amartya Sen and Martin Nussbaum in general. And the third one, which is, I think, the most interesting for the domain of education or for educational justice, is the principle of recognition. This is the principle, I will call it principle of respect egalitarianism. I think you were talking a lot about this principle of respect egalitarianism or about recognition. And this third principles is linked basically to the name of Axel Honneth, but also to authors like, for example, Elisabeth Anderson. Now, let me start first with the structure, with the logical structure, and also with the shortcomings of the principle of distribution, the principle of luck egalitarianism. So, the distributive notion of justice and of educational justice is about searching for a principle or for a norm for a fair distribution of goods. So what Rawls and more explicitly Dworkin emphasize at that place or in that perspective is that the distribution of goods could be only then fair when this distribution is made according to choices the individuals can be held responsible for. And that is why this principle, so the distribution according to achievements, the principle of distribution of goods according to the so-called achievements of the individuals does not apply in the sphere of education, in the sphere or in the domain of school education, because in the domain of schooling, we are not dealing per definition with individuals who can be held responsible for their choices and therefore for their achievements, since we are dealing here with children, and children can not be held responsible for, by definition, for their achievements and for their choices. And this is a very important, distinction between, very important difference between children and adult persons with regard to this principle of fair distribution and redistribution of goods. Especially in the sphere of education, it is important, very important to emphasize that, of course, individuals are not responsible for their family background and even for what Rawls calls natural gifts, talents, whatsoever this means. So what is actually the consequence Rawls and especially Dworkin are drawing from that line of argumentation? The consequence is that both of them, and especially Dworkin, more strong and more clear than Rawls, are articulating a call for redistribution of educational resources aiming at the neutralization of the so-called bad brute luck. So the purpose of schooling, morally seen, consists basically in improving the starting conditions of disadvantaged children. We cannot have a fair competition, even later on in the sphere, in the domain of labor and of economy, if these undeserved inequalities in the family, with regard to the family background, or even with regard to different levels of talents, of natural gifts, are not neutralized through school education. And that is why even Rawls makes the argument in his theory of justice that school education, and especially elementary school education, should be characterized by a significant redistribution of goods and resources, educational goods and resources, in favor of disadvantaged children and persons, disadvantaged both again by the family background and also by so-called talents and natural gifts. Now, how we can deal with this call. So the question is, what this call, what this argument, does it mean practically for educational policy? How this neutralization of different starting conditions, so to say, can be realized in the practice, in the by educational policy and by different type of pedagogies? So Harry Brickhouse was dealing a lot, or is still dealing a lot, with that question. And with regard to that question, he articulated the so-called, or he formulated the so-called bottomless pit problem. The bottomless pit problem means that it is simply not possible to equalize the educational conditions of advantaged and disadvantaged, privileged and less privileged children and families by redistributing more resources and more material goods in favor to the disadvantaged. This is what the bottomless pit problem means. Why is that the case? We can observe it. We can observe this development in different countries. I think also probably in India. Once this redistribution of material goods, of financial resources, for financial resources in favor of the poor families, of the poor children, takes place, at the same time, the wealthy families are trying to segregate their children from the mainstream, from the public school system. And this is a cause for a widespread of private school. It is simply the case that many wealthy parents simply don't want that their children should experience a kind of common schooling with the children of the less advantaged classes and groups. And that is, so the spillover effect is a widespread of private school and private schooling. What is the solution to that problem which Brickhouse offers? It is a very provocative solution. What Brickhouse and also other authors are arguing for is the so-called leveling down of educational expectations. So the argument or the claim of Brickhouse is that only by a general leveling down of the educational expectations, educational standards in a national educational system, and probably also globally, a kind of equalization between the opportunities and the chances between the advantaged and the less advantaged or disadvantaged families and children can be achieved. Another solution, or another proposed solution for that problem by other authors would be simply to ban private schools. So, and you can imagine a picture, ideal picture of having only public schools which deliberately leveled down their expectations in order a equality of opportunities to be achieved. So these are there are at least two problems with regard to these two proposals. The first one with regard to the call for leveling down is quite obvious one. A democratic society and a society of knowledge in the global world presuppose a permanent knowledge and permanent growth and production of knowledge, and it does presuppose, of course, competent citizens. So the call for leveling down works, of course, against this these requirements before a democratic society and a knowledge society. The second one, the second problem could be more controversial. This is the problem with the call for banning private schooling, for banning private school. We can discuss probably this problem also in the discussion. Of course, if you are going to a private school, normally you have a lot of advantages, and you didn't deserve disadvantages because you are able to go to a private school simply because, normally because you are coming from a wealthy family. And disadvantages seems to be unfair. But on the other hand, we should also remember that a lot of private schools are developing a lot of pedagogical innovations, at least in European, I think also in the American context. So, for example, the most Montessori schools or the most schools in the, who are favored in the so-called child-centered progressive pedagogy, the most most of the such schools are private ones. So one can argue that ultimately many private schools do contribute for the further development of schooling or further development to the improvement of the quality of schooling in a national educational system. At least in the context of Germany, there are some private schools who are integrative one, which is not the case in the sphere, in the domain of public schooling. By integrative, I mean that these are schools where 20-30% of the students are with physical or mental disabilities. And at least in the German context, these are mainly private schools who are performing this kind of integrative teaching, who are including students with mental and physical disabilities in the normal, so-called normal classrooms settings. I must add that, of course, the tuitions for the students with mental and or physical disability are paid in that case by the state. Another case, I think, is the case with the charter schools in the United States. Charter schools could be seen as a kind of third form, as a kind of midway between public and private schools. As far as I know, charter school can be seen as private operated, private organized, organized by private initiatives and private groups, but they are founded by the state. So the question is, of course, whether or not it could be that the model of the private school couldn't be a kind of ideal or the most promising way to reach even more inclusive education or more just education, but I cannot deal with this question now for time reasons. But still, here are a lot of open, unsolvable problems, I think, and the approach of the so-called minimalist or threshold egalitarianism try to answer to give answer precisely to this bottomless pit problem. So, what is the basic idea of the minimalist egalitarianism? The basic idea is that there should be a threshold of equality, and this threshold should be reached by all students who absolved the secondary school of a society, but above the thresholds, inequalities above the thresholds are not matter of justice or injustice anymore. And these are two different versions of the approach of the minimalist egalitarianism. The first approach focuses exclusively actually on political participation and political education. This is the approach developed basically by Amy Goodman, and she defined her threshold of just or egalitarian education as follows. There should be a threshold of competencies and skills which should be achieved, reached by every absolvent of the secondary school, of the high school. And these are precisely the abilities and the competencies which makes possible for the individual to take effectively part in the political, at the political life of her society. So these are the competencies like be able to understand the role of the given society, the political structure of the society, also being able to follow the discussion, the public and political discussions in the society, and being able to participate actively in these discussions. One problem with this approach is, of course, that it reduces education to political education, or it reduces education to political participation. But of course, education is about much more than only political participation, although, of course, enabling political participation is a very important task or aim of formal education. The broader version of minimalist egalitarianism is the version of the so-called capabilities approach, developed basically by Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum. And this version reads, generally speaking, speaking as follows. Every student or every absolvent of the high school in a national educational system should be able to develop some central human capabilities which are necessary condition for leading or living a life in dignity. And Nussbaum offers even a list of 10 central human capabilities. This is, for example, the capability of political participation, but this is also the capability of enjoying the life, of having a body integrity, of being able to communicate with the others, and so on and so on. But again, inequalities which are above this threshold are not matter of justice or injustice, fairness or unfairness anymore. They simply do not matter anymore for a conception of educational justice. So, and this is precisely the problem with that approach. For, I think that we all have the intuition that by talking about justice and injustice, we are talking about comparison between different individuals, between different levels of opportunities which the individuals have. Now, we don't have any more this discrimination between advantages and disadvantages once the threshold is reached by everyone. But let's take the following example. We can imagine a public school in a poor neighborhood, a public school which somehow managed to cultivate these basic capabilities in all of its students. But that's all what this school can achieve. So there are no foreign languages in there. There are no, for example, art or music classes and so on, because, for example, foreign languages. And this is also about, in that case, gender-based domination, inequality, and so on and so on. So the most interesting question for me is, or for probably two questions, and I'm going also to, in that way, also to concern the other questions which were related also to that question. So the first question is, what is the relation between testimonial and hermeneutical injustice on one hand and the broader concept of disrespect on the other hand? This is an interesting question. I think that, for example, the examples given by Fricke are too simple, in order to be applicable to more demanding pedagogical contexts. And that's why I was trying this, to indicate this relation between a theory of epistemic injustice and theory of respect or disrespect, and to spell out testimonial injustice and hermeneutical injustice in the terminology of respect. Okay, and the second one is, of course, about institutionalization of pedagogical practices. So it is not the case that the teacher should be blamed for not being empathetic with the children or being disrespectful. The case is rather that there are some structures, some social structures, some political structures, which do not allow the teachers to be empathetic with the children or to give respect to the children. One such structural cause is, for example, the case when you have a kind of purely canon-oriented teaching. So as teacher, you are obliged just to transmit some body of knowledge, some body of facts, and then you don't have other choice but just to put the children in different boxes. Here are the talented children, there are the less talented children, and so on and so on. This is a structural problem. This is not the problem of the individual behavior or consciousness of a teacher.